great when we see people who've committed their lives to Christ make that public affirmation. And be in prayer now for Aaron and his family. And we're going to have a continuing morning of great worship. Welcome to all of you. We're glad you are here. I have a lot of announcements today, and I think that's wonderful because even during a pandemic, we are still doing the Lord's work here at Crank Chapel. We are still involved in ministry. We are still telling people about the love of Jesus, and I think that's wonderful. It's amazing. I will start by inviting you to Pastor Ed and Carmen's class today at 11:11. They are going to talk about how does God want us to live. Tomorrow, for all of you board members, there is a board meeting at 6 p.m. tomorrow. And this Wednesday, Super Kids begins at 6:30. So please be in prayer for Super Kids and our teens in the Refuge program. Thursday, we have really exciting news. We are going to start another worship service. So we will have the 8:30 service on Sunday. We'll have the 10 o'clock service on Sunday. And on Thursday evenings, we're going to have a 6:30 service. It'll be the same as the Sunday morning service, same content. We feel this is important for people who maybe can't come on a weekend, maybe they're working, or maybe circumstances prevent them from attending on a Sunday morning. So we want to provide that opportunity during the week. So 6:30 this Thursday, we begin our new worship service. So you are welcome to attend that or tell others that you know of who are having difficulty getting here on Sunday, that there is that opportunity. Thursday is also Ruby's Pantry out at the fairgrounds beginning at 5 o'clock. So if you participate in that, that's Thursday at the fairgrounds. On Saturday the 26th, we will be participating in The Return, which is a time for turning back to our Lord and Savior, repentance, revival. It's occurring in Washington, D.C. that Saturday. And we are going to simulcast, and we are also going to have a time of prayer. And we will give you more details as that time comes closer. October 2nd, we are starting a Bible study called The Armor of God, and that will be every Friday evening at 6:30. It's a 7-week video Bible study. It's going to be led by Terry and Christine McBain. We're asking that you do sign up in the foyer or call the church office so that we can prepare the materials for that Bible study. So be thinking about that beginning on October 2nd at 6:30. On October 3rd, there's a women's retreat at Cedar Springs Camp. And all of the information is on the bulletin board in the hallway. So if you're interested in attending that women's retreat, be sure to check out the bulletin board. On the back of your sermon notes are some of these announcements. But like I said, we've got so much going on, there wasn't even room for all the announcements. And so we're praising the Lord for all the opportunities of ministry and service that He's giving us. And now we will welcome Pastor Mike.
Morning, church. So I'm taking this class called Pastoral Counseling. And the one thing that we're talking a lot about right now anyway is self-analysis. They believe that if you don't know who you are, then you can't help someone else. So we had a guy last week, he made this comment that really kind of hit home, and as he said, I am my best, or when I am at my best, I see God. And I thought about what does that mean, when you're at your best, you see God? Well, the way I understood it was, when we're doing God's work, we see His hand at work. You know, when you do something good for somebody, it makes you feel good. Well, that's part of, I think, what this guy was trying to say, is when he's doing God's work is when he's at his best. That's when he sees God. So I think that's something that, you know, the 1 week I talked about unconditional love, and it comes with a cost, a price. Well, I think that also part of the joy we get in doing that is we get to see God's hand at work. So that being said, let us pray. Dear Father God, we love you and we thank you for this day. We thank you for all that you do. You are so good to us. You show us mercy. You give us life. You give us goals. You give us just so many things, Lord. You bless us with so much abundance. We are grateful for the things that we have received. We ask that you bless our tithes today, and we ask that you have your way in this service and that Pastor's message will be well received. And we just thank you for all that you're doing for us and allowing us to see you, your hand at work in everything that goes on day by day. And Lord, we just, again, thank you for everything that you do and for who you are and for all that you have given us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, this morning we would ask that you would join us as we sing songs about grace.
Good morning, good to see you. That sheet about baptism that I mentioned earlier is on the back table and out in the entryway, and it just talks a little bit about what the Bible says. Jesus told us if we love him to show it and to acknowledge it. And the way that he gave us, one of the ways, is baptism. So we're always glad when people do that. We're starting a series of messages today, and they all begin with the power of. God works in our lives in many ways. He releases his power into our lives through many channels. And as we cooperate with God, as we open our hearts to God, as we allow him to work in us, things can happen. And so he shows us what he wants. And today he's going to give us words about the power of another chance. A farmer in the old days was going to clear a field, and he chopped some trees down, but he had these big old stumps that he wanted to get rid of. So he went into town, went to the general store, and told the fella he needed 10 sticks of dynamite. And so the fella got them, and he said, "Now, can you put that on my bill?" And the store owner asked him, "Have you ever worked with dynamite before?" He said, "No, this will be my first time." He said, "Then I want you to pay cash." There's some things in life where if you make a mistake, it's just kind of not going to be another chance on that. But there are times when we do learn from what goes wrong, don't we? And God tells us that he wants to teach us. You know, in the Bible, we learn that people who mess up aren't passed up by God. Aren't you glad for that? Aren't you glad that you didn't just get one chance to respond to God? We see many examples in the Bible. Abraham lied about his wife and said she was his sister. He did that twice, got her in a mess. Sarah, his wife, lied about or got angry and impatient when things didn't happen the way she wanted. And so her jealousy and impatience got her and Abraham into trouble. Rachel stole some things and lied about it. Moses had trouble with anger. He even killed a man. David also killed a man, but he also had sexual sin in his life. Solomon worshiped idols. Jonah tried to run away from God, and Jonah actually hated the people God wanted him to tell about his love. Peter wouldn't admit that he even knew Jesus, and Paul was part of a mob that killed an innocent person. Over and over in the Bible, we find that a lot of the people who served God in memorable ways failed him first. They weren't always cooperative and teachable even when they said they would follow him, and they tested his patience over and over. And yet God didn't throw them away. It isn't that their sins didn't matter, it's that God cared about them anyway, and he had a plan. Their sins were serious, their sins deserved punishment, but God's love and grace are much bigger than our failures and our faults. That first song we sang, "Grace That Is Greater Than All Our Sins," it's really true. There's nothing bigger than God's grace and mercy in our lives. Now, God hates it when we sin. He's the source of all true justice. He's righteous in every way. There's no flaw with God. There's never an inconsistency with God. And he insists that everything be right. He created a universe that runs on certain laws. Light and sound and other things all work by certain patterns that God established. And he wants that same kind of pattern morally. And as the ultimate judge of the universe, he never compromises. He never covers over sin. And yet the Bible says that God is rich in mercy. The Bible says that he's abounding in grace. There's just an awful lot of grace with God. And so God combines grace and mercy with justice. One doesn't give out at the expense of the other. He makes both things happen. God deals severely with sin, but he also makes a way for sinners to escape the punishment and the doom that they bring on themselves. How does he do it? Jesus took the punishment that we deserve. When Jesus hung on the cross, he paid the penalty for every sin ever committed. Now, some people reject Christ. They don't want his forgiveness. He died for them anyway. The price is paid anyway. If they don't receive it, they don't get it. But it's available. He isn't going to drag you into heaven against your will. So when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, God justifies us. The simple explanation of that is he treats us just as if I never sinned, justified. And that means that when God looks at me, he doesn't see the record of my failure and my sin. He's forgotten it. Why? Because Jesus took the brunt of that on himself. And when I give my life to Christ, he covers that sin. He took the punishment. The debt is paid. There's nothing left on the record. Now, sin is a big deal. It ruins everything. It befouls the world that God created to be very good. It makes us self-centered. It makes us petty. It makes us hurtful, even though we were created in God's image. Sin ruins everything. It's a disaster. Look at all the evil in the world. If you want to get a good night's sleep, the worst thing you can do is watch the news first. And yet, grace is bigger than all that sin. Jesus will wash away our guilt when we ask him to. His empty tomb emptied sin of its power over us. His empty tomb empties sin of the power of death over us. We can live forever. We can be forgiven. We can be children of God because of Jesus. He treats us different than we deserve. Why? Because he treated Jesus different than he deserved. Jesus never sinned. And yet he was punished as the worst sinner of all, as the ultimate sinner. And because Jesus was willing to be treated as a sinner, God can treat me as a son and you as a son or a daughter. Grace is big. It's huge. And because of Jesus and what he did, because of grace, forgiveness is possible. I remember standing in a jail cell with a man who had killed somebody. He said, "Could I ever be forgiven?" I said, "Yes." How did I know that? The Bible says it. The Bible tells us about killers who've been forgiven. Redemption is within the reach of anyone. You can become a different person in Christ no matter where you've been. And we can reverse course. No matter how far we've gotten from God's plan, we can come back to him. We can miss his will over and over, but you can't cancel out grace. It's still there. He still looks at you and sees what he intended you to be when he created you. He still wants to restore you to that beautiful plan that he had when he made you. Listen, you may run 10,000 miles from God's plan, but you'll never be one inch away from his love. You just can't get away from his love. You may be unrecognizable compared to what God has created you to be, but he can bring you back to that plan. So pause and let that sink in. You're never going to be away from his love. Nobody you know is away from his love. Nobody you're praying for is away from his love. God's heart aches over our sin. It hurts him when we allow it in. It hurts him when we welcome it in to our lives. He feels that pain as he sees the distortion of what he made and what we've made of it. We're intended to somehow in a unique way, every one of us is different from everyone else. In some unique way, we're intended to show something about God in our personality and in what we do and in our gifts and how we use them. We're meant to express the wonder and the beauty of God with our personality and our personhood. And yet we descend into pride and greed and hostility. And sometimes people go their whole lives and never really come back to God. He'll let us, but he hates it. And I'll tell you this about God. God never gives up. He won't write you off. He won't say, well, that's a lost cause. Not worth making any more effort there. He holds back the punishment that we deserve. How many of you have been in a car wreck and you could have died? How many of you have fallen off the roof or out of a tree or down the stairs? How many times could you have died? You know, by the time a kid is 16, he's had about 16 guardian angels, you know? And yet, God's grace is that he gives us time. He gives us time. He leaves the porch light on. He leaves the front door unlocked so we can come back. We have a home to come to. We have a father to turn to. And he reminds us that he's there. He reminds us of his goodness. He reminds us that he cares in all sorts of ways. Just you go outside and a bird is singing. And God is just saying, hey, remember? I care about you. I made this world. I made it to be beautiful. I made your life to be beautiful. He's constantly calling us back to him. God never gives up. Would you read that with me? God never gives up. It's true. You can bank on it. You can base your life on it. If you want him, he wants you. He's inviting us back. He's protecting us, giving us time. He's paying attention to the details of our lives. And he's eager to help us do the right thing. You think you want to do the right thing? God is 1,000 times more motivated to help you do that thing. And the way we come back to God is to reverse our course. Instead of plunging onward in the sins that attract us, we turn back in his direction. Those sins that look so good and didn't satisfy, we turn away from them. We turn our face to God. We peel our grubby little fingers off our own plan for our lives, and we reach out to take hold of the hand of God so that he can lead us. We tune into his voice. We look in his direction. We open our eyes. In short, we repent. Repent means we turn around. We come back. Come back to God. We come back to the source. We come back to the origin of our lives and of everything around us. We set aside our way for his way. We let go of anything that he can't bless. And we choose him above everything else, including our own attitudes, our own actions. It costs something to repent. You have to be honest. You have to look at yourself. You have to see what's there. You have to call it what it is. You have to admit the harm that you've done to yourself and to other people. You have to be willing to see sin for the ugliness that it has, for the destruction that it brings. You need to renounce it, which means to let go of it and say no more of that. Now, the thing about human nature, we all know this, is that you can't just say, I'm done with that, and you really are, right? I mean, it's the same. We say, I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to start exercising. I'm going to be nicer. It's a constant effort. It's not just something we just one time say. And so repentance is a way of life for people who want to follow Christ, because we keep veering off and doing our own thing, responding out of our old nature, and we need to keep coming back and turning back to Jesus over and over. But the Bible promises anyone who wants to can come to Jesus. Listen, you don't need someone else's permission. Sometimes a person who's committed a crime will give their heart to Christ, and someone who is a victim of that crime says, no way. Nobody can veto God forgiving you. No one else can intervene in your relationship to God. It's you and him. And he says, whoever wants to can come. He wants you back. We can exchange our sinful ways for his purposeful ways. We can toss aside our guilt and shame. We need to learn from it. We must never forget how we've fallen, because we want to be wiser because of it. We don't want to continue to be ignorant, but we can take advantage of God's offer of forgiveness. We can be forgiven. I want you to see a scripture from John chapter 8.
But Jesus walked out to the Mount of Olives. Then early the next morning, he went to the temple. The people came to him, and he sat down and started teaching them. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law of Moses brought in a woman who had been caught in bed with a man who wasn't her husband. They made her stand in the middle of the crowd. Then they said, "Teacher, this woman was caught sleeping with a man who isn't her husband. The law of Moses teaches that a woman like this should be stoned to death. What do you say?" They asked Jesus this question because they wanted to test him and bring some charge against him. But Jesus simply bent over and started writing on the ground with his finger. They kept on asking Jesus about the woman. Finally, he stood up and said, "If any of you have never sinned, then go ahead and throw the first stone at her." Once again, he bent over and began writing on the ground. The people left, one by one, beginning with the oldest. Finally, Jesus and the woman were there alone. Jesus stood up and asked her, "Where is everyone? Isn't there anyone left to accuse you?" "No, sir," the woman answered. Then Jesus told her, "I am not going to accuse you either. You may go now, but don't sin anymore." Once again, Jesus spoke.
It's early in the day. Jesus has gone to the temple. He's teaching. And in comes a little parade. The religious leaders with their catch of the day. A woman caught in adultery. In the very act, they said. They arrogantly point out how despicable she is. And you have to wonder, what happened here? Why did they bring one person? There had to be two people involved. Where's the man? Where's the other person? What's going on here? Did you set her up? Is this some kind of trap that you set for her? It probably was. There certainly was a trap to get Jesus in trouble. They knew that if they asked him about this, that if he said, "Yeah, you should follow Moses' law and stone her," he would be in trouble with the Romans. They had taken charge of Israel, and their law prevailed, and they had to give permission for something like that. And so Jesus would be in trouble with the government if he agreed with that. On the other hand, if he said, "Well, just leave her alone," he would be in trouble by saying, "God's word doesn't mean anything." Now, this law of Moses has been superseded over the because of Christ. We don't stone anybody to death. We don't carry out punishment. And yet, it was at that time the law of the land. But these people who came weren't really interested in justice. They weren't really interested in this woman in any way. They humiliated her publicly in the most holy place in the world, the temple of God. They were proud of themselves for capturing her. They were using her as an object for their political advantage. The man who was with her the night before may have been using her. They certainly were using her as an object. Their motives were purely selfish. They hated Jesus and thought she might prove useful in bringing him down. She had no value beyond that. No one there cared about her feelings. They didn't care whether she lived or died. They didn't care about her eternal soul. They treated her with contempt and put her to shame. They think they have a clear case legally because they've caught her in this situation. but they're missing what matters far more. Jesus said the greatest of all God's commandments was to love God, and the second was to love people. And they had skipped over all of that. They had no concern about God. They had no concern about anyone, especially this woman. Their attitude was totally wrong, and they were there for their own selfish goals. And so how in the world could they do any good? You know, there are things in our culture that are clearly wrong. You read the Bible and you say, you know what? This thing that people do is a sin. This idea people have is wrong. God says no. And we can name things as sins. It's appropriate to call things what God calls things. But we must never treat any person with contempt. We must never look down on someone because of what they've done as if somehow we're better. That old saying is true. Hate the sin and love the sinner. Jesus stood up against sin, but he stood up for sinners. Jesus lived only to please his Father. That was his goal every day. That's what he wanted to do. He stayed focused on God. He didn't let other people come and set the agenda for him. He got his agenda from his Father. And so when these people came, Jesus didn't respond right away. He stooped down, he started writing in the sand. People have been curious, what in the world do you suppose he was writing? Was he writing names? Was he writing the sins of these people? Was he, if they looked down, would they see, oh, lying, I guess I, does he know what I said to my mother last night? I don't know what he was writing. I don't know if it was words or what it was, but he was taking time to let his Father show him the next thing to do. Sometimes we all need time, don't we? When he was ready to respond, he stood. He said, you know, fellas, you're right. There needs to be justice. We need to carry out the will of God. We need to have a society that honors God. This is what our nation is built on here in Israel. So tell you what, the first stone will hold back, and the first guy who's never sinned can start the cause of justice. The first person who's not guilty before God of anything else can punish this woman for her guilt. Well, they had enough integrity that they all knew they were sinners. They all knew it. There isn't a person alive who's worthy to throw the first stone. Jesus was. But nobody there. And so he calmly stooped down and started writing in the sand again, and the arrogant accusers felt the spotlight shifting from this woman to them, from what she had done to what they were. And the ones who wanted to publicly expose her sin all of a sudden were faced with their own. The ones who wanted to cleanse the earth of an evildoer like this were suddenly reminded that they were in the same class. Their political posturing turned out to be morally bankrupt. It always is, political posturing. It falls short. And all of a sudden, their zeal for justice melted away, and they just wanted to get away. And so one by one, they leave. Until finally, it's just Jesus and this woman. Now as citizens, as voters, we need to stand for God's values. We need to oppose things that God is against. But we must never put ourselves in another category from other people as if somehow we're different. We fall short too. Our sins matter. You know, when you put your faith in Christ, it does not make you better than other people. It should make you behave better. And it will make you better off. But we're all, the ground in front of the cross of Christ is flat. We're all equally sinful and guilty before God. That doesn't mean if you're going to sin, do everything. It doesn't mean it doesn't matter. What it means is we need a humility that says we're people who've received grace. We've been given mercy. We didn't get what we deserved. We've gotten things we don't deserve. And if we've been given grace, we want to give grace. And so when everyone was gone except Jesus and this woman, he asked her, "Where's the guys that wanted to kill you?" And she said, "Nobody's left." And then Jesus said, "I will not condemn you either." He could have thrown the first stone. He was guiltless. But he had no desire to. He said, "You can go." He chose mercy. He didn't want her to be punished. He wanted her to be changed. He didn't want her life to end. He wanted it to be different. He let her go home. But he warned her, "I'm not excusing your sin. I'm not telling you it's okay. I'm not saying go back to what you've been doing. Listen to God. Do what he says." He lovingly offered her a chance to come back to God. Her life wasn't over that day. It could have been. And we don't know what she did. We don't know if she went back to her lover. We don't know if she went back to a life of sin. We don't know if she began to follow Jesus. We don't know if she's in heaven or hell today. We don't know about her. What we do know is that we have choices too. And like her, our choices determine our destiny. And the time will come when we too will make our last choice. We can allow God's mercy to draw us to him. The fact that we woke up one more day, the fact that we haven't been punished for what we've done. Or we can not turn to him. We can justify ourselves. We can minimize our sin and say, "It's not that big a deal. I didn't do that much. Other people are worse." We can refuse to see how what we are and what we do offends God, who is our maker and who will determine what fits into his heaven and what won't. Every day we get another chance to do what's right. Every day. Can't change yesterday, but I can change myself. I can change my attitude. I can open up to God. And like that woman, someday we will have our final chance. Whether we know it or not, that will be it. And our destiny will be set by what we've done and chosen and thought and received. The power of another chance is the opportunity to let God make us what we're meant to be. Do you want that? Do you want to be what God made you to be? Do you want to do what he made you to do? Do you want your life to count for something that will last forever? Well, we have another chance. Aren't you glad that it isn't just a second chance? His grace is bigger than our sin. His plan is bigger than our mistakes. His gifts are bigger than what we deserve. Let's make sure we respond to his grace. Let's set aside a sinful life to follow Jesus. Let's over and over say yes to him. Yes to him. Yes to him. Yes to another chance. Yes to a chance today to do God's will, to be God's person, to bring glory to his name. Yes, Lord Jesus. And the fact that we say yes, we can't even take credit for that because he drew us to it. He helped us do it. He made it happen for us. He helped us. He gave us grace. We're going to sing about that one more time this morning. God's grace working in us. And so the power of another chance is really the power of grace, isn't it? Let's honor God as we sing this song. Everywhere you go, you're in God's grace. Every breath you breathe, you're breathing in grace. You don't have to go find it. It follows you. It fills you. It's right there. We just need to respond to it. We need to say yes to it. We need to say yes to Jesus. He did provide forgiveness, but we have to say yes to it. We have to agree to it. We have to say, I want that. It does matter what we do. It does matter how we respond. And yet, no one in heaven will ever be bragging what they did. It'll all be about Jesus. But make sure you say yes to him. Make sure you say yes to the gift of salvation, forgiveness, becoming a child of God. Make sure you say yes to that. And then let's all of us go forth in grace alone. Let's say yes to God every day, to his power to change us and help us and work through us and fulfill his plan, because we've agreed to be partners. Let's be his people. You want that?
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, I pray that you would help all of us to say yes to you today. If you're not sure you've said yes to Jesus as your Savior, you can pray right now quietly where you're sitting. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you that you love me. Take my life and make it yours. Forgive me for my sins and make me the person you want me to be. And give me the strength to follow you day by day. And if that's your prayer, you've become a child of God. And he'll help you to live that out. And all of us are still working it out. And Father, help us that we would go forth in grace alone, drawing on your strength, repenting as we need to, and becoming the people you've intended us to be since the beginning of time. Letting our lives count because we're using them to be what you want us to be. To do and to say what you've led us to do and say. Make us your people, we pray in your holy name. Amen.